If tomorrow I lost it all, and everything that I had was gone, when there's nobody else to call, would you stand by me? Would you stand by me? When the world tries to keep me down, and there's nobody else around, keep it real, can you tell me now? Would you stand by me? Would you stand by me? Dreams come true.
And welcome back to Claws and Cameras. My name is Paula Trujillo, and I'll be introducing to you Panther News. For our first story, we have Mr. Candelaria, our new Austin staff member, and he came to improve our law enforcement program. Here's what he had to say. Just recently, we had a new teacher come to Austin High School, and he came to improve our law enforcement program. His name is Mr. Candelaria, and here's what he had to say.
I am one of the law enforcement teachers here. Before coming in, I was a United States probation officer. What that is a federal probation officer. I did that for 20 and a half years here in the Western District of Texas, El Paso Division. What I do is I will, first and foremost, I'll tell the students what it is that we're gonna be covering. And what I found is in order for students to understand what they're reading, I have them go over the vocabulary first. And I know that students don't necessarily like having to write out the vocabulary words, but in the way of writing it out, they're practicing one of the writing skills, and they're also having to understand what they're writing. So when they go into do their readings, their assigned readings and assignments, they already have the background of what the words are that they're gonna be reading for the first couple of times. Also have them do group discussions, several different activities, and then on certain days, usually on Fridays, we have hands-on activities, which can be anything from teaching them defensive tactics to handling weapon, handcuffing, scenarios, use of force, use of our MILO system, so they can get a hands-on experience as to what it would be to be in law enforcement.
I've learned a lot of new things that help me with my everyday life, and it's just been an overall good experience for me. He's a very good teacher. He was a really good substitute for Mr. Quinlan. Well, he connects with the students a lot, and he doesn't just like ask the class as one. He tries to talk to us as like individuals. Well, I enjoy what we learn, the hands-on stuff, the strategies that we learn, and all those types of stuff. I connect with him, like, I really feel like he's my friend because he cares about me and we all have a good laugh once in a while.
Ready, guys? Class, sit up.
Sports are still full in action. Football has ended, but we still have a long road to go with basketball, wrestling, swimming, and many other sports.
Hello, Panthers. My name is Jacob Rodriguez, and I'm here with Panther Sports. We will be recapping varsity football team. The varsity football team ended with a 5-6 overall record and a 3-1 district record as they got second in 1-4A.
I feel our season went well. You know, everybody has their own opinions, but the only opinions that matter is ours, the players, and our football family. I think it went well. Despite finishing second place, we always aim at finishing first. Didn't happen this year, but the season went well.
I think there was a lot of improvement across all levels. The seniors really set in stone what the standards were. The underclassmen, they have a lot to work for, and hopefully we set the goals.
Some of the standout moments were when we had the kids that we didn't expect to play the way they did, to play the way they did. You always have high expectations for everybody, but you know, on Friday night when we're driving home and on weekends when we work, we talk about kids who are achieving and outperforming others.
Well, next year it's going to be a lot to look forward to. It's going to be a bigger team, more experience, better players. So it's definitely going to be a team to worry about in 4A next year.
I want to thank them. I thanked them already over the weekend. I thanked them last week. I thank them for leaving a legacy, whichever legacy they want to leave. Everybody leaves a legacy, and their legacy was 4 years of hard work.
I would tell them to continue grinding no matter how the season ended or how it finished. You always got to continue and look forward to the next year. Never stop lifting weights, you know, put in the work. When nobody's looking, that's when diamonds are created.
I want them to realize that hard work does pay off. This was the first COVID group, the only COVID group, I guess, that they missed their freshman year. They only had 3 years to play. So they made it special. They won some championships along the way, and they finished second place, which is nothing to be ashamed of right now.
It feels great. It feels like an honor. It's what I wanted to do when I first came in here. You know, when I was a freshman, it was William Rodriguez here. He got drafted like top 10 in the senior showcase, and that's always been a goal for me. I wanted to be drafted up there.
The girls varsity volleyball team finished 12-20 overall record and a 4-4 district record as they got second in the 1-4A district and unfortunately came up short against the Riverside Rangers in the bi-district championship. We will be introducing wrestling. They had a meet at Hank's on November 11th. Here's what some wrestlers had to say.
Oh my God.
Okay, since this is my last year, I have to go out and compete like it's like my last tournament ever. So I have to go out and not regret anything and leave it all out there.
Well, I mean, I was hoping to do a bit better, but I mean, first match of the season, it is what it is.
My next tournament, that one's gonna be in San Antonio. It's gonna be a little bit tougher than the one we just had. It was at Hank's. It was a dual meet, and I went undefeated.
It's nice to mentally know what I'm getting into. The first time nerves aren't there so much. You know, I don't blank out whenever the whistle blows. Like, you know, I have a better concept of what I'm doing. You know, I need to take whatever criticism I'm given from my coaches, you know, take whatever advice they give me, go into a club to get some extra practice in. So just putting in the extra work where it's needed.
We have a total of 8 tournaments, and I really want to place first at all of them and go and dominate districts, regions, and state. My head is just set in stone on going to state and placing. We're a small team, nobody really knows about us, but after Saturday's performance at Hank's, they will definitely remember us.
Now we will be introducing boys basketball. Their last game was on November 13th against Riverside Rangers and came up with a victory of 68-41. And their next game at the Cathedral Tournament on November 16th through the 18th.
I mean, I feel like it's going great. You know, we just had our first game on Monday. Well, my first game was on Monday, and I feel like I had a great game. I'll say G, Angel, and then Santana and Anakin, and TJ too. Just make it farther than the area around, you know, just try to get more gold balls and get a district gold ball too. We just all got in rhythm and we just hit all the shots we took. We finna win district and make it farther than the area around, you know. Panthers up, slap!
Now we'll be introducing the girls basketball team. They had a game on November 14th against El Paso High School. Here's what Brian had to say.
Hey Panthers, I'm Brian Perez and I'm here with the Austin girls basketball team. Today we take on the El Paso High Tigers. Here's what a player and a coach had to say.
After halftime, a lot of our turnovers, like, they just messed us up. I feel like the hype was there the first two quarters, and just silly turnovers, silly mistakes, like dribbling into 2-3 girls. Like, it was just dumb little mistakes that cost us the game. But doing what they're doing, I mean, we've got pretty far. Like, we have a pretty solid team this year, and I feel like just as long as we keep working, doing what we're doing, and like focusing on our goal, which is, you know, like playoffs, district champs, all of that, we should be good.
We always start off slow, and then towards like halftime, we always pick it up. So we have to start with that same intensity as like the beginning of the quarter. I feel like we had a growth, like a big one. Like, we really, like, it's just, we have a team chemistry. Like, it's just really good.
Once we're playing in district, which would be like YWA, Bowie and all that, but I think we got it. I think as long as we focus, like lock in, like we should be good.
Diving into swimming, their last meet was November 3rd through 4th at the Cathedral Loreto Invitational Meet. And their next meet is the 17th and the 18th at the EPISD Invitational Meet.
Well, we have a lot of new swimmers. So obviously we still have to work a lot on technique, make sure they get their strokes down. They don't get disqualified in conditioning. Then we get in the water and we do a little bit of warm up in the water. And then we start our main sets where we work on speed or technique or power. And then at the end, we try to work a little bit on diving, turns. And lately we've been doing a lot more speed work. So, you know what, we're growing and we have a lot of enthusiasm and it's turning into a positive thing for our school. Last year, our boys won the boys championship and we're trying to get the girls up there too, so we can have dual champions as far as that's concerned. And right now the numbers are showing that. So. Goals for my team, the boys, well, since they won last year, is to win again. Actually to win again in a more dominating fashion. I don't know if it's gonna be possible or not. We have more competition this year. And for the girls, we were second last year and it's gonna try to make a better effort to kind of be champions, district champions this year. But also for them also, you know, to always improve their time and their toughness, mental toughness, and learn some life lessons according to them.
Well, obviously, I want a lot of our new people to be able to feel more confident in their abilities and what they can do in swimming. And I'm really hoping, since we got a lot of new swimmers in here, that they can make it to regionals and they can be proud of what they do and swim. Honestly, it's pretty nerve-wracking, but I feel like I can inspire these people to do what they can, and I really feel like I can make these swimmers a lot better and a lot more confident in what they're doing. Personally, my goal is to be able to just compete in every event as best as I can and be able to uplift others as well. So watch out, because we got a lot of new swimmers and they're gonna be very good.
That's it for me, Panthers, and stay golden.
Hi, my name is Adrian Cardosa. I'm a Panther at Austin High School. We will be interviewing people about littering in Austin High School.
Elizabeth Valdal Gonzalez.
Yes, ma'am.
I think it's really, really bad because kids are just being lazy. Our janitors work very hard and there's usually a bunch of trash cans around for them to use, and I think we need to learn just to pick up after ourselves. I mean, I think it should just be natural to kids to throw away their trash, but I mean creatively, like, maybe we could have some volunteer groups, or maybe we could have a competition, like if we catch kids picking up trash, even trash that isn't theirs, maybe we can get some kind of PBIS reward.
I'm Christina Bercher. I think that the littering kind of makes the school look bad, like it makes the school look like ghetto and cheap in a way. And I think just by putting more trash cans and like making it aware, I think that it is a big problem and it makes us like look bad as like just a school, because this is us representing our community and obviously we're not representing it very well.
Brandon Cohn. Well, it's unfortunate to say the least, because you walk around campus and you see a lot of excess trash, whether it be on the stairwell or in the hallways, outside. I think the kids here at the school, really kids and adults, need to treat it and be very responsible when it comes to excess trash, because remember, when you see trash and you're a visitor or you're even a student, the first thing you see is that trash on the floor. You want to keep this beautiful school as clean as possible, because we have one of the most beautiful campuses in the whole country, and especially the city of El Paso. Kids need to be held responsible for their actions. People need to be held responsible in general. We need to basically, I think, implement incentives as well. If you see trash, pick it up. You will be rewarded. But not only that, but again, show them that this is one of the most historic and beautiful campuses in the whole city. And I think that you need to educate them as well and make sure that they understand that this is where they are. They spend the majority of their time. So we want it kept very nice and beautiful looking.
Do you know what Día de los Muertos is? Do you celebrate Día de los Muertos? If not, here is Mariluisa Chavez with more information.
Good morning, Panthers. My name is Mariluisa Chavez. Today, I got the honor to talk to teachers and students who participated in Día de los Muertos. Here's what they had to say.
Uh,
The Day of the Dead is a celebration of life. It takes place in Mexico and other parts of Latin America. It blends both indigenous traditions and the Catholic faith, some elements of Catholic faith. That's called syncretic. So it's a mixture of those two belief systems.
We make, we visit our loved ones in their graves or ashes, and we make like an altar for them, offering the stuff they used to like when they're living.
Well, again, it has its roots in the indigenous history of Mexico. It's generally in the south. The states, I think, where it's most prevalent would be Michoacán, Oaxaca, for sure. Probably Chiapas, those types of places where there's a strong indigenous past, where it's more culturally.
An ofrenda is like a present or something we give them so their spirits can enjoy it.
It's an altar. There's three parts to it. Each part or each stage of it represents a different part, maybe the underworld or hell, this world and the next life or heaven. Oftentimes in each one of those it'll be decorated with, they're called marigolds in English. That has a symbolic value. Oftentimes there'll be a picture of the loved ones who has passed. They'll put such things as salt and water. Many times they'll have an offering.